Hello there, I'm B. Welcome back to biology. Last time we took a look at some of the biodiversity that exists on Earth. Today we are going to explore biodiversity on a different level, which explains why you and I and all the other humans on Earth have so many physical differences, even though we are all members of the same species. Think about your natural hair color. Is it the same as your parents' hair color? Do you have dimples when you smile? And if so, does anyone else in your family? Oh, here's a fun one. Can you curl your tongue? There's a good chance that someone in your family has some of these traits in common with you, but it doesn't always have to work out that way. We'll look at why that is. After today's lesson, you'll be able to explain how traits are inherited through alleles, describe the difference between dominant and recessive alleles, and understand how DNA is organized into chromosomes. And that means that today we are focusing on the third theme of biology, reproduction and inheritance, which includes genetics, the study of how traits are passed from parents to offspring. Have you ever looked at a family tree? It's an easy way to see relationships between you and your nearest relatives. Biologists use family trees too to track the inheritance of traits. In this family tree, we're going to track the inheritance of red hair. Obviously, quite a few people in this family have red hair, but not everyone. When scientists want to use a family tree to investigate an inherited trait, we call it a pedigree. And instead of using pictures, we use symbols to keep things a little simpler. Let's look at what these symbols are, then we'll put them on our family tree to make it a pedigree. Males are indicated with a square and females with a circle. If the shape is a solid color, the individual has the trait that is being investigated. An empty square or circle indicates that the person does not have the trait. Pause the video for a moment to fill in what these symbols mean in your notes. On our family tree, notice that the grandparents and great-grandparents have already gone gray or bald. We'll have to dig back through some old photos to find out what color hair they used to have and mark it correctly in our pedigree. Let's add these shapes to our family tree so we can more easily see how the red hair trait is passed on from one generation to the next. One new addition to the family doesn't have any hair yet. Since we don't know if he will have red hair, we'll give him a question mark for now. Scientists would rather study the trait from a pedigree like this because it makes it very quick and easy to tell where the trait is within the family. But why does red hair get passed down through families like this? And why is one side of our pedigree all red hair and almost none on the other? To answer this question, we need to learn a few new words. Inherited traits are passed down from parents to offspring as genes. For most genes, there are two possible versions that you could receive. Each version of a particular gene is called an allele. So we can say that you have two alleles for every gene because you got one from mom and one from dad. The two alleles you receive might be the same, or you might get a different allele from each parent. In this example, mom has one allele for red and one for not red. Dad has two red hair alleles. You could only have received a red hair allele from dad, but from mom, it was a 50-50 shot. And you happen to get the red allele from her as well. So you now have two identical red alleles. Take a guess. If the allele you get from mom is for red hair and the allele you get from dad is for red hair, what color hair would you have? It's pretty obvious here that you would have red hair. But is it possible to get a red hair allele from your parents if they don't have red hair themselves? Or what if only one of them does? Could you still have red hair? To answer that, we need to learn just a couple more terms. Alleles can be dominant or recessive. If the allele is dominant, you only need one copy of it in order to show the trait. So, if you get a dominant allele from mom, it doesn't matter which allele you get from dad, you'll have the dominant trait. But if an allele is recessive, you need two copies of the same recessive allele in order to show the trait. The only way you can have a recessive trait is to get the recessive allele from both parents. It turns out that red hair is a recessive trait. So to have red hair, you have to get a red hair allele from both mom and dad. But that doesn't always mean that mom and dad both had red hair. Let's look back at our pedigree. Notice on the top right side, two non-red-haired parents had a red-haired son. This is because both parents were carriers. Being a carrier means that you carry a recessive allele for the trait, but you don't show the recessive trait because you also have a dominant allele. So you show the dominant trait. In the example we looked at earlier, mom was a carrier because she had a red hair allele, but did not have red hair herself. If you have a child, one of your two alleles will get passed on. If you are a carrier, it could either be the dominant or recessive one. It's a 50-50 shot. And if both parents are carriers, there is a 1 in 4 chance that both will pass on the recessive allele, giving their child a recessive trait that neither parent has. Here's a thought experiment for you. Based on what you know about dominant and recessive alleles, do you think it's possible for two redheaded parents to have a child with anything other than red hair? Think about what alleles each parent must have and what they will pass on to their offspring. Since both parents must have two red hair alleles, they will only be able to pass on the red hair allele to their children, so they can expect to have a whole brood of redheads. Now, what about our mystery child on the pedigree who hasn't grown hair yet? I bet his parents are waiting with bated breath to see if those first hairs pop out red. What do we know about his parents? Mom has red hair, so he's definitely getting a red hair allele from her. Dad doesn't have red hair, but they've already had one child that does, so dad must be a carrier. It all depends on dad. Either he passed on his recessive red hair allele or his dominant non-red hair allele. And that will determine the hair color fate of his son. It's a 50-50 chance, so they'll just have to wait and see. Hair color is an easy way to see how traits get passed along through genes, but genes are responsible for much more than hair color. They do determine many of your physical characteristics, but more importantly, they contain the instructions for all of the important processes that go on inside your body to keep you alive. Let's look at one example. Have you ever gotten a paper cut? Ouch! It may bleed, but usually only for a minute or two. Your blood produces clotting factors that will plug the hole and stop the bleeding. These factors are activated in step 1. Platelets form a plug in step 2, and by step 3, the cut is sealed, at least temporarily. This all relies on protein that is produced by a certain gene. All genes contain instructions for making proteins, a type of molecule you'll learn about more in the next unit. But what if you inherited a mutated copy of this gene from your parents? This can cause low levels of the clotting factor to be produced, such that your body can't stop the bleeding as quickly. This is a condition called hemophilia. In step 2, the clotting factors are activated, but notice how starting with step 3, the clot isn't able to form properly in the blood vessel of the person with hemophilia, and the bleeding will continue in step 4. This means that people with hemophilia can be in danger of bleeding to death from a relatively small cut. Luckily, this is a recessive trait. So as long as you receive one good copy of the trait, you won't have hemophilia. Here's a bit of history trivia for you. It has sometimes been called the royal disease, because in the 1800s it was passed down from Queen Victoria in England to several of her children, who then married into various royal families across Europe and passed the condition to their royal children in those countries as well. A total of 9 royal males inherited the disease between 1850 and 1914. But why only males? It's not a coincidence. Males on average have a 1 in 10,000 chance of having hemophilia, while the odds for females is closer to 1 in 100,000. We'll look more closely at why this is during our genetics unit. Until then, you can ponder the mystery. Another condition caused by a single gene is called Achoo! Syndrome. No, I don't have allergies, but this condition will cause you to sneeze when you first come into bright light. It's a dominant trait, so if you have a tendency to sneeze as soon as you walk outside on a sunny day, there's a good chance that one of your parents has the condition as well and passed the dominant allele on to you. This is also sometimes called photosensitive sneezing. We've talked a lot about genes today, but what is a gene? And where are they in your body? Simply put, a gene can be thought of as a unit of inheritance. You may already know that your body is made of trillions of tiny cells. Inside each of those cells is a molecule called DNA. That stands for deoxyribonucleic acid, but we'll just go with DNA for now. In humans, each set of DNA is organized into 23 chromosomes, and each chromosome has hundreds to thousands of genes on it. You have approximately 25,000 total genes in your body. Most of these genes contain instructions for things you will never even be aware of. They tell your body how to digest your food, make blood cells, control your growth and development, and more. Sometimes many genes work together to produce a single trait. That's why there are so many possible eye colors. 16 different genes control your eye color, which makes a lot of combinations. Wow, I've thrown a lot at you today. Let's stop there and recap what we've learned. We looked at how traits are inherited through alleles. We saw the difference between dominant and recessive alleles, and we learned that DNA is organized into chromosomes. So, I have another thought experiment for you. See if you can identify other traits that you think might be genetic. Look at your parents and maybe other family members to try to find a trait that you think you have in common. Our genes make us who we are, and your genes came from your parents. How much of you do you see in your family? Until next time, remember, biology isn't just science, it's the way of life. Hey, hey.